may I request of you to keep your questions till the end? Maybe you have to write them down. I will now call Patricia, who is, I'm sure you all know this fact, she's the first and the only non-Muslim Malaysian who has obtained a PhD in religion specializing in Islam. And there's something that I am very, very, very admirable, that I admire very much. She has a very long CV, but I will not read all of them. But I must say something. The one thing in her CV that really attracted my attention was she was a consultant to UNICEF for an Indonesian pilot project to adjust curriculum of primary school to enable them to accept and appreciate the differences between race and religion. I wish Malaysia does something like that. Indonesia always takes the lead role. So Patricia, you really must share me the findings of your consultancy in Indonesia. As agreed, 20 minutes.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. I'm grateful. I always say this because all it means is peace be with you. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for replying to me. Sometimes it's met with silence. All right. I'm very grateful for the fact that Professor Piscatori set the framework within which I'm going to speak. What I want to describe are actual empirical evidence, statements issued by authoritative non-Muslim organizations like the Malaysian Consultative Council for Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Hinduism, Sikhism, and Taoism, by the Christian Federation of Malaysia, which covers 90% of Christians in Malaysia and comprises three components: the Catholic Church, the Council of Churches, which is the Protestant umbrella, and the Evangelical, National Evangelical Conference, Federation, something like that, NECF. We always know them as NECF. And so this is where my material comes from. Obviously, speaking in this context, as already Professor Piscatori has told us, and Narayani has informed us even more, I am going to speak relatively negatively about our experience. That does not make me anti-Islam. I'd like to make that very clear, because having the PhD in Islam and all that kind of thing has gotten me into horrendous trouble. Professor Piscatori mentioned Al-Mawardi. I wrote a two-section article, two sections, in Malaysia Kini, deconstructing the book Malaysia Adalah Sebuah Negara Islam after Mahathir announced that we were a Malaysian state, an Islamic state, I'm sorry. And in it, I analyzed this Al-Ahkam al-Sultaniya, which I've read in Arabic, and I debunked how much was manipulated and how much was lied about. So, please note, I am not anti-Islam. I cannot study Islam and stay sane if I do not love the religion. I lived for a whole year in Al Bayt University in Jordan. I lived in a sakan, in the dormitory for women. I wore the hijab and the jilbab. And so, when I first read the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it moved me so very deeply. But I'm going to be honest with you, I see very little of that in CHAP, what I call CHAP Islam Malaysia. CHAP is the Bahasa word for brand. Brand Islam Malaysia. Okay, now let me go on. I'm giving you perspectives from the other. I'm pressing page down. How come it's not moving? Press enter. Okay. I used a quote from the description of this forum. Others have used it, and you know what it is. I ask, isn't it an Islamized state already? Because here we're discussing Islamization and what's good and what's bad. I don't say it is Islamic, but it is Islamized. There's a difference. By the MCCBCHST, which I just told you about, the module is recognized by the government for non-Muslims, non-Muslim religions as early as 1986. I have the booklet here. We understand and appreciate the desire of our Muslim brethren to live according to their Sharia, and will leave the non-Muslims totally free, emphasis theirs, to choose to live under the present civil law of our country. Then we praise our Muslim brethren for their sense of justice. Now, this is in 1986. The variety of different, this is the continuation from the MCCBCHST. Now, here's the protest. The variety of different interpretations of the Sharia has led to different treatments of non-Muslims, discrimination in Malaysia. In moral education, in our schools, only Islam is taught, no other religion. In university, the mandatory Islamic civilization course is unjust in a diverse and plural nation. Crosses have been removed from mission schools built and run by our Christian religions. The discrimination against non-Muslims, they continue, this is from the MCCBCHSD still. There have been distorted write-ups of religions other than Islam in school textbooks, anti-Christian khutbah, which are official, anti-Christian social media and digital media are distributed freely despite our protests and police reports. In 1986 already, they had written about children below the age of maturity have been unilaterally converted to Islam by one parent. Later on, almost 15 years later, then it becomes a huge issue as it is now. But already they were talking about these problems. Non-Muslims are forbidden to use certain words of Arabic origin, but which are now in the Malay language, Allah, Kitab. In Penang, even Haji is not allowed. So, you know, don't ask me how I'm supposed to address someone who's Haji. Dear person who took a flight to Mecca and circumambulated the Kaaba, you know, it just gets ridiculous. We note that Christians in the Middle East use all these words. When I went to church in the Middle East, we didn't suddenly become able to speak in French or Spanish. We spoke in Arabic and I prayed to Allah. So anyway, more recently, just one example. Now this one is from the Christian Federation of Malaysia. Oh, before I end with the MCCBCHST, what I quoted was from 1986. In 2007, they brought out another booklet entitled Unity Threatened by Continuing Infringements of Religious Freedom. And there's a whole booklet on it. I'm not going into it, there's no time. I now want to discuss just one statement from the Christian Federation of Malaysia. I'm on the executive committee, but if there are any media here, please do not say I am representing CFM today. I'm here in my personal capacity, although I'm on the executive committee. The statement in July, the 2nd of July 2016, says, non-Muslims as kafir harbi in a fatwa on those who oppose hudud. The press statement says, the Christian community strongly condemns the use of the incendiary term kafir harbi, which is used to describe unbelievers at war with Islam, but now applied to all Malaysians who oppose hudud. Enactments, questioning, doubting, or this is still part of the press statement, questioning, doubting, or rejecting any change in laws or policy, such as with establishing hudud, is the fundamental constitutional right of all Malaysians. It is regrettable that a state mufti, the most senior Islamic cleric of a state, and who is also a public servant, uses the term kafir harbi without a thought as to what it may conjure up in the minds of Muslims and Malaysians. We appreciate that some Muslims have spoken out strongly against this extremism, and this has heartened many of us who live in multi-ethnic, multi-religious, and multicultural Malaysia. And someone who does that very often is Farouk Musa, and I want to give him credit. We should celebrate our diversity if we are to remain united as a nation. And all forms of bigotry, racism, and divisiveness should be condemned. I've written at the bottom, this is not from their statement, but I've written, fatwa not withdrawn. In fact, he went on to defend it even more. So it's sitting there, the fatwa stays there. Okay. Now I'm going on the other tangent, discrimination in favor of Muslims, and I only give one example. As I said, I could do this all day, but just one example. In most town structural plans, there is a huge disparity of proportions for the building of mosques versus temples and churches. One example of one town. In Ipoh, which is majority non-Muslim, I'm a Perakian, yeah. Muslims for mosque, the allocation ratio is one mosque for 800 people. The space that the state normally gives is 0.6 to 1 hectare. For temples of all sorts and churches, the allocation ratio is one church for 1,500 people. And the space that is allocated is 0.4 to 0.8 hectare. Can you see how one feels then as a second-class citizen? I refuse to use the word dhimmi. Ahlul Dhimma or Dhimmitude ended in 1863 with the edict Hat-i Humayun in the Ottoman Empire. That was the end of dhimmi, and we are not going back there. Okay. Historical trajectory, very briefly. Please, if you haven't, read Joseph M. Fernando's The Making of the Malaysian Constitution, written in published in 2002, because the person who spoke before all of us spoke was saying he was confused and Islam is the religion of the Federation. There is no confusion. It is very clear from the papers that Joseph Fernando got. He went to London to the colonial office and got the actual notes, the actual transcriptions, papers, everything, that the Reed Commission gave the Muslim rulers the option about how Islam was to be positioned or phrased. Their reply, the reply of the sultans, not an Islamic nation, but the official religion of the Federation. There is a huge difference. Official religion of the Federation of a nation would include everybody who lives under it and acknowledge that the majority are Muslims. If you say we are an Islamic state, that's a whole different matter, as James Piscatori has informed, and as I have researched extensively and written about. Our first Prime Minister, God bless him, Tunku Abdul Rahman, Arwah Tunku Abdul Rahman, recorded in the Hansard in Parliament, so this is non-debatable, he clarified we are not an Islamic state or nation. And yet, we hear Daula Islamia, and just now James Piscatori, professor, used the word Din wa Daula, and I laugh aloud when I hear this, because Daula in classical Arabic simply means wealth or property. But now it's trajected into a Westphalian notion of a state, and we have Daula Islamia. It's the same thing as Sheikhul Azhar, Yusuf Karadawi in 1970 saying, siyasa, politics, doesn't appear in the Quran, so I don't know how we're going to do this juggling act. Also, the other phrase that's used a lot, al-mulk, the reign of the Prophet, peace be upon him, that was a fledgling community of Muslims beginning to forge understanding how to live among others as a growing community. That was not the blueprint of a state, again I repeat, the Westphalian state, that whether from Iran to even Saudi Arabia, frankly, that's what it is now. Okay, so that was a little tangent, that's not there. However, Islamization continued, largely for political expedience. I'm not going into it, Norani did, Professor Piscatori did. But most of all, for conflating Malay identity with Islam, ethnicity and religion are both strong primordial instincts. And this Norani didn't mention it, the conflation exists in Article 153 of the Constitution. And this has cemented Malay ethnic solidarity for UMNO's slogan, that's our ruling party, for all the years that we've been a nation, Perjuangan untuk bangsa dan agama, the struggle for race and religion. And then they become these champions of the struggle by stoking a siege mentality. Islam is always under attack by Christians, by liberals, by feminists, by LGBTQ, by Jews and Zionist plots, I don't know what and where else. Hence the concept of Kutuan and Melayu or Malay supremacy has stoked a siege mentality. Norani mentioned that. The resurgence and revival of Islamic identity in the 80s, the Dawah, that becomes Dakwah here, co-opted by the ruling BN coalition led by Dr. Mahathir Mohamad to make Muslims accept his developmental agenda. He had absolutely no intention of making us an Islamic state. He just wanted development at all costs. By 2020, we were supposed to be a fully developed nation. Most courses, books, mission statements of institutions had Islam in them, even a book, which I have, called A Tawhidic View of Management by Aikim, with American best management practices, but packaged as Tawhidic. I mean, okay, but no comment. Dakwa in Malay, is rampant among non-Muslims because here it is used not so much as dawah among Muslims for them to be in obedience to Allah and to follow the tenets of Islam, but to proselytize, to increase the slim majority then, it's increasing now, of Malay Muslims in Malaysia. Yet, the constitution does not allow, it forbids non-Muslims from proselytizing to Muslims. We accept that because I, for one, cannot accept my constitution and use it as my shield, freedom of religion, freedom of speech, if I won't accept what else is in it. So I accept about Malay privilege, but then it's argued as Malay rights. That's a very big difference. These are the way things get manipulated, as James Piscatori told us. The authority to do this and who wields that authority. Okay, I'm going really fast. A quote from the description of this forum, you can read it very quickly, about the Rukun Negara being promoted. I am on record as stating that I oppose this for two reasons. Number one, the first principle of the Rukun Negara is belief in God. And although I am a practicing Catholic, I will defend the right of atheists. If not, we end up with a Raif Badawi in Saudi Arabia, 500 lashes for never, not even declaring he's an atheist, nobody dares to, but writing in a blog about atheists. The second reason is this: our constitution is already in tatters, in my opinion, humbly. It is manipulated, it is misinterpreted, it is discarded and disregarded, and we don't need a qualifier on top of it to confuse things further. Okay. Quote from the description of the forum to show you how closely I'm sticking to what we were told to do. Status quo as a result. I have written about this actually, both in a book evaluating Mahathir's administration and in a journal article. I say that Muslims in Malaysia have been infantilized. They are told all the time what they can do, what they can't do, what is haram, what is not haram. As my Muslim friend, I won't mention his name, in Singapore wrote about this latest uproar over paintbrushes being of pig bristle, he said, "Wow, I had no idea that Muslims in Malaysia ate with their paintbrushes and stirred their curry with their paintbrushes." Okay? You never know, don't be naughty. I respect my Muslim brothers and sisters. They've got a lot more brains than the people who said that Muslims are not so smart. Thank God Farouk Musa spoke up. I was so angry. I am not a Muslim, and I was so angry. How dare you speak about your ummah? Muslims are not so smart, so we have to tell them what to do. This is what I mean by the infantilizing. What I have also written about, God, 15 years ago, the core and periphery syndrome, which is extremely important in understanding Muslims elsewhere in the world, everywhere. The core is Saudi Arabia, where they turn to five times a day. The periphery would be Malaysia, Indonesia, and so on. A, Most can read the Quran, but they cannot understand Arabic. They are not heirs to the huge resources, the differences of opinion, the richness of philosophy. So what happens is the mediators, the ones who claim in the land of the blind, the man with one eye is king, the ones who claim to interpret are the ones with the power. And this is why we have what Norani calls that silent middle class. I say that they've got terrific opinions on politics, they are intelligent, they are as talented as anyone else, but when it comes to Islam, they are infantilized, they're told what they can and can't do. It's punitive, you get punished for even criticizing or questioning a fatwa, when in all the madahib, that's the plural for madhab, in all the madahib, a fatwa is nothing more than the learned opinion of a mufti. Even our Sharia courts till today do not necessarily take into account a fatwa. That's a fact. So, in this core and periphery syndrome, they are basically led by the nose. So Islam is punitive, and many Muslims are afraid to speak up. And the key words drummed in for over 20 years, which is by their own Muslim authorities and leaders, Muslims are confused. And the latest is, you're not so smart. This doesn't help, because somewhere, if I say it often enough to you, this is what brainwashing is called. If I say it often enough to you, you begin to believe it. If I tell you you're an idiot, at some stage you'll start to wonder if you are one. Okay. Malaysia adalah sebuah negara Islam. This was the booklet, I call it by stealth. After Mahathir proclaimed us an Islamic state, they published, Jakim published a booklet. Because Mahathir has stated nothing has changed. He's just cutting the ground from underpass state doctrine. He opened a Pandora's box. And we had the MCA, so let the non-Muslims take equal blame. The MCA and Gara Khan and all were holding seminars, some of which I went and attended. I was being told nonsense like, a rose by any other name smells as sweet. This challenging and dire situation of an Islam that is divisive is exacerbating exponentially as the ruling party uses Islam for credentials as good Muslims, despite the scandals that beset it. And I better not say any more about that. You all know. You can go to Malaysia Kini and get these two articles, two sections of one article that I wrote. It was written only in Bahasa Malaysia by Jakim, only distributed in mosques, but I got one copy. The primary source is the Shafi'i jurist Al-Mawardi and his Al-Ahkam As-Sultaniyah. I expose the manipulation of what is mustahakka and what is mustahabba and what else was conveniently left out. And we have ample examples of how what is mustahabba, recommended, becomes mustahakka in the hands, in the land of the blind, the man with one eye is king. So our church in Shah Alam, which has been relegated to industrial land, a factory lot, got building plans approved by the BN government. Everything was approved, and suddenly we had to stop building because someone in the Majlis Agama Islam said the church will be higher than the mosque. Now that's in Al-Mawardi's Mustahaba, not in Mustahakka. So we took them to court and we won. I'm coming to the end of it. What I suggested, you know, I want to cry when I read this out to you, because I wrote an article, Race and Religion in Malaysia, Problems or Process. I wrote it almost 13 years ago, and the date was before our National Day. I'm ending with this now. Thank you for your patience, madam. These are quotes. More than many societies in the world, most Malaysians have constant, real reminders that we are around someone of a different race and religion. Perhaps we are so comfortable with this element of exposure and inclusion that it is simply taken for granted. And I think this is true. Think about it. Why don't we explore how most of us, especially in urban settings, live and enact this interreligious and interracial coexistence and engagement on a daily basis. We ride the same buses, we go to the schools, we buy and sell from each other in the market, we pay tax. She's yelling me, yeah, we pay tax. We sit together here and listen to whatever you may not like or you may like, and we do it. Almost done. We are not self-conscious enough, I wrote, nor explore enough how it is we have learned to live together for 47 years. Now it would be 60 years today. Despite some serious episodes of problems, it is not just legislation and leaders who have affected our harmony. Quite the opposite. I want to say that again. What I'm telling you is that ordinary Malaysians have given us the peace that we have had for 60 years. It is not legislation, it is not our leaders. The reality is that most Malaysians on a daily basis enable and enact both our differences, because we're all very proud of our religion or culture or whatever. She called me Chachat for being Catholic. Okay, I'm kidding. As well as our cohesion, the credit is to us, ordinary Malaysians. What we need now is the space, both real and metaphorical, and the latitude to think and talk realistically about our ability to live together without ignoring the problems. Instead of having civilizational course and devising workshops on how to teach people to live together, National Unity Consultative Council, God bless them, whom the Prime Minister has totally ignored, but who went around having town hall meetings, asking people, what do you want to complain about and what do you want to have done? No, ask people how we have managed to live together. We all know from, I hate the word lowest to the highest, but from the ordinary person like me to maybe a sultan, with all respect to them. We need to develop the skills to put these problems in perspective for each other. We actually have the skills. When I want to talk about how I hurt, that I had to pay for my PhD myself, that I cleaned houses and toilets sometimes to fund myself until Yale and Temple and everybody else gave me scholarships. I say it in a very polite way, and my Muslim friend sometimes is in tears. They don't understand or realize it. We need to be able to talk to each other. Right now we shout like this. And who's doing the shouting? Politicians on our behalf. No need. Like this. We need to develop the skills to put these problems in perspective for each other. I'm very moved when I read this, and resolve them amicably. Most of all, we need to identify and discover together the joys, the successes, the capabilities we have evolved about living as Malaysians. We ordinary Malaysians. And this comes not from pie in the sky. I wrote this after I came back from doing the UNICEF project in Indonesia. And thank God, alhamdulillah, until today, there has been no more Maluku and no more Ambon. We worked really hard. We changed their syllabus. We did many things. But it was about asking. I met with parent teachers associations. I'm not interested in the Minister of Education. I never met him once. But we met with ordinary people and ordinary children, and we asked them, what frightens you? Difference, xenophobia. So we debunked that. Okay? So we ordinary Malaysians, we can do it. Thank you. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Patricia. Thank you very much.